large part of the worry with this COVID-19 virus right now is that the mutations are going to catch up to us and overrun us before we are able to catch up to the virus in terms of immunity. If enough people do not become immune in time and the virus continues spreading, the chances are that a lot of different mutations would come out there. And we're seeing some of that already. We already see some of these different strains popping up. The UK has 3 different strains. The UK has the Kent strain, the Bristol strain, the Liverpool strain. There's a South African strain. There are 2 different Brazilian strains. There's a possible Californian strain. There's also a possible Philippine strain. They presume there's also possibly even an Indian strain. So there are different strains coming around. And what the worry is that some of these strains will become resistant to the vaccines that we have. Before we get the vaccines to enough people, that enough people are immune and we reach herd immunity. The idea is, if we can reach herd immunity before these mutations reach, enough people wouldn't be able to get the virus, that it wouldn't spread that much and the possibilities of mutations decrease. One of the ideas many people have to upping or increasing the rate at which people become vaccinated is allowing more producers to produce these vaccines, allowing vaccine production companies in all different countries, especially in a lot of the poorer countries, because yes, there are vaccine producers in even poorer countries. Vaccine production isn't something that necessarily requires the most high-tech labs. Vaccines have been produced since the 1800s. It's not something that only requires top quality cutting-edge technology in the most wealthy countries. So the presumption is that if the patent issues are lifted on these vaccines, meaning that a lot of these vaccines, the recipes for them are patented, the pharmaceutical companies that developed them or bought the rights to their development own the recipes for these vaccines. You cannot just go and produce this, because one, you don't even know how to produce it, and even if you got the recipe and you produce the chances are you would be under copyright or patent infringement. Hey, don't forget to click that like button. If you like the video, if you don't like it, comment and tell me what you don't like about it. Especially if you reach the end, comment and tell me what you think. Comment and tell me a topic you'd like to hear me do some research on. I tend to go at things I find interesting. Maybe something you find interesting, I'd find interesting too. Subscribe and get some notifications when the next videos are out. I'm releasing them as soon as I can. And I guess with this pandemic, I may be able to release some sooner than I thought. The idea is being pushed by some lawmakers in some of the first world countries. One potential solution is sharing vaccine patents with countries that are lagging behind in vaccination efforts. Last week, a group of progressive lawmakers urged the Biden administration to consider temporarily lifting patent protections for COVID-19 vaccines and treatments. The White House convened a meeting on the matter late last week with no final decision reached. South Africa and India have made a formal request to the World Trade Organization to waive COVID-19 related patent protections until the world reaches herd immunity. International humanitarian groups, including Doctors Without Borders, urged wealthy countries last month not to oppose the intellectual property waiver at the WTO. As we've learned, viruses don't care about borders. We have to vaccinate as many people as possible, everywhere in the world, as quickly as possible. Why wait and watch instead of getting ahead of this? Devi Sridhar, a professor of global public health at the University of Edinburgh, who participated in the People's Vaccine Alliance service, said in a statement through Oxfam Tuesday. So this is a proposal, not just being proposed by some fringe people out there. Many people, including scientists and people within governments, are proposing this idea as a possible solution. You see, the thing with a global pandemic like COVID, the possibilities of mutations affects everyone. So even if you have your entire population immune, your entire population vaccinated, you reach herd immunity. Someone from some other nation may have a mutation that is resistant to your current vaccine program or your current immunity, and they can come into your country, and now you have a whole new problem created. Everyone's favorite billionaire to hate on, and some do like him actually, Bill Gates, who was recently asked what he thinks about this proposal. And this would be important to ask him, because he's one of the people behind the COVAX Institute. If it sounds familiar to anyone, this is the institute that is allowing us in Trinidad and in some of the other smaller and poorer countries to have access to these vaccines. Because what they're doing, they're creating avenues for us to speak to the vaccine producers and negotiate with them to buy, in our case, or in some cases actually providing these vaccines for a much cheaper cost to these countries. The aim of the COVAX Institute is to get as many people vaccinated as possible, especially in these poorer nations. So we think, thinking about that aim, that someone behind this institute would like to see as many people get as many vaccines for as cheaper cost as possible. But when he was asked, he said no. In an interview with Britain's Sky News this week, the billionaire philanthropist was asked if he thought it would be helpful to lift intellectual property protections on COVID-19 vaccines. To many people's surprise, his answer was no. The thing that's holding things back in this case is not intellectual property, Gates said. It's not like there's some idle vaccine factory with regulatory approval that makes magically safe vaccines. You've got to do trial on these things. And every manufacturing process needs to be looked at in a very careful way. There's only so many vaccine factories in the world, and people are very serious about the safety of vaccines, he added. Moving a vaccine, say from a Johnson & Johnson factory, into a factory in India, it's novel. It's only because of our grants and expertise that can happen at all. It's interesting that he used India as the example, because India has been the largest vaccine producer in the world for quite some time. India has been the largest vaccine producer, and the single largest vaccine producer in the world is located in India also. This is SII, the Serum Institute of India. All of this begins to sound really suspicious, and a bit self-serving is when you read into some of the history of it. The current Oxford AstraZeneca shot was being developed in Oxford. While it was being developed back in April, we saw in an interview, Adrian Hill, the director of the Jenner Institute of Oxford, describes his team's progress on a vaccine. He doesn't believe in exclusive licenses, he says. Nobody is going to make a lot of money off this. An open licensing regime is a potential boon for India, which has dozens of vaccine plants across the country. The scientists at these plants are experienced and the production costs are low. That seems to sound contrary to what Bill Gates tried to accuse them of, but okay. If the Oxford vaccine succeeds in trials and its license is opened up, events that are potentially months away, India can find a way to put all these plants to work manufacturing it. Bearing in mind this was back in April last year. Days later though, AstraZeneca announces that it has secured the exclusive license to the Oxford vaccine. Why the plan changed never becomes fully clear, but the Gates Foundation may have had a lot to do with it. We went to Oxford and said, "You are doing brilliant work," Bill Gates tells reporters a few months later. "You really need to team up," and we told them a list of people to go and talk to. So Bill Gates and his foundation went to these same Oxford scientists that were developing this vaccine and told them, "Hey, you're doing really good work. How about you team up with someone of these corporate pharmaceutical companies?" And they gave them a list to team up with. And all of a sudden, this team that previously was of the opinion that no patent should be there, there should be no exclusive license to something such as a vaccine, they're all of a sudden now giving exclusive license to AstraZeneca. And the strange thing about all of this is AstraZeneca then turns around and licenses the same product to be produced in the same India by the same Serum Institute of India, the largest vaccine producer in the world. Now AstraZeneca gets a cut of this profit by producing it there. So a lot of the logic that Bill Gates is attempting to use there, that these nations can't produce this, seems to be negated by the actions that these same pharmaceutical companies are doing, where they're getting the exclusive license, so they own the license and the patent, they own the recipe to produce this vaccine, but hey, y'all can produce it in these countries for cheaper, and we would collect money from this. The confusion that a lot of this created a lot of the problems that India is seeing now. Well, didn't create the problems, but it added to the problems, it didn't help it certainly. So we have this largest vaccine producer in India, and they get the rights only from AstraZeneca. So it's not like all these other vaccine producers within India can help to produce more. All production must occur in this from this one producer. And then, because they're producing a licensed product, they have limitations imposed on them from AstraZeneca and from the Western world. For example, in March this year, when the UK begins to fall short of AstraZeneca vaccines, the company imports 5 million doses from SII. This seems to contravene SII's agreement with COVAX that, aside from supplying India, the company will prioritize COVAX production for low-income countries. The SII vaccines went to the UK as part of a secret quid pro quo struck between the British government and AstraZeneca. So AstraZeneca is dealing behind people's back with the British government, and now because they're licensing the product for SII to produce, the Serum Institute in India, the British government now can, as it will, commandeer 5 million doses from SII. All of this while India is struggling for doses, and SII said to have an agreement with COVAX. COVAX is again the institute being backed by Bill Gates and his financiers that is saying they want to provide these vaccines to poorer countries. So while SII is supposed to be producing for us poorer countries, the British government is creaming off a 5 million doses if they need it just in case. Some of this seems like a particular conflict of interest because Gates himself is invested in a few of these companies, at least a few that we know of, because some of his investments aren't exactly the most known thing. One thing we know for sure is that Bill Gates is invested in Pfizer. The Gates Foundation also owns shares of the big drug maker. However, this investment wasn't initiated because of Pfizer's coronavirus program. Actually, the foundation first bought its stake in Pfizer back in 2002 with the stated intention of expanding access to the pharmaceutical companies all-in-one injectable contraceptive Cyanopress, giving women in the developing world an affordable option. So they've been invested in Pfizer since 2002. They've been invested in BioNTech, and Pfizer and BioNTech have partnered together to produce one of these vaccines. They're also invested in CureVac. They're also invested in VIR Biotechnology. And these investments are spattered all around the vaccine development industry. So for him to say that what they're interested in is keeping the patents and the real reason is safety, it sounds really bogus, because a lot of people already don't trust these vaccines that are being produced, even in the first world nation. Some of this could already be seen in that many countries seem to rather go with the Sputnik vaccine. The Sputnik vaccine is created in Russia. It's made by the Gamaleya Research Institute. That's a Russian funded institution. They're under the Russian Ministry of Health. So it's a state body, and they produced their Sputnik vaccine since last year, and it has had good results. The difference with the Sputnik is it uses some older technology compared to some of the other vaccinations. They use the more familiar, a variant of a virus where they put in some of this new virus DNA into it, and then they inject that into you and your body responds to that, hopefully producing immunity. Recently saw that St. Vincent may have to find a way to give away or find some other use for 50,000 of their AstraZeneca doses, because the AstraZeneca dose has a limited shelf life and the doses that they currently have may be going to expire before people take them. The citizens apparently don't want them. The St. Vincent and Grenadines government says it has ordered 50,000 doses of the Russia-developed Sputnik V COVID-19 vaccine as nationals continue to refuse taking the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine to help curb the spread of the coronavirus pandemic here. Now, some of that isn't overly surprising, seeing that a lot of the officials in St. Vincent have already taken the Sputnik vaccine. And if my officials took the Sputnik vaccine, I may feel more lean towards taking the same vaccine that they took. Prime Minister, in responding to some of this controversy, said that the chief medical officer, Dr. Simon Kaiser-Beach, had informed him that people are requesting the Russian vaccine, which he, the CMO, and other senior officials have taken in the past. I am going further and asking you, pleading with you to take the vaccine. It is important to your health. We have only had 13% of the population who are vaccinated, Gonzalez told radio listeners. I know that some persons have some queries about the AstraZeneca vaccine, but all the scientific reports would tell you with crystal clarity that any risks involved with the AstraZeneca are minimal and the benefits are huge for any of these vaccines, Gonzalez said. They reduce markedly transmission, they reduce the possibility very significantly of you getting seriously ill, and certainly reduce the prospect immensely of you dying with COVID. So I'm urging, he said, adding that the CMO has told him that there are lots of people who say that they would take the Sputnik. Some of them say they want to take the Sputnik, which she took, which Roger, the medical officer of health, Dr. Roger Duncan, took, which Comrade Ralph took. Well, if that is true, remember I had written to the Russian authorities in relation to the Sputnik, and we have received an offer to purchase. Well, they have sent a draft contract for us to purchase 50,000 treatments. That is to say, both components, the first and second jab, the Prime Minister said. Something to bear in mind with the difference between the Sputnik vaccine and the other vaccines is that the Sputnik vaccine, the two doses aren't the same dose. There's the first component and the second component. With most of the other vaccines, the Pfizer vaccine, the AstraZeneca vaccine, the Sinopharm, which is the Chinese vaccine, that all require two doses, the two doses are the same thing. So you can receive the first dose, and in another shipment of what may have been intended to be a first dose for someone else, you can receive that as the second dose also. But with the Sputnik vaccine, the Russian vaccine, what needs to happen is you need to have two different doses for each one. They aren't the same thing repeated twice. They're two different doses, component one and component two. And possibly leading the charge out front in the Caribbean in terms of having the most of these Sputnik vaccines would be Guyana, who intends to vaccinate their entire population by 2021. And that seems to be very possible for them as they arrange a deal for 400,000 doses of the Sputnik vaccine. And I believe they're close to vaccinating 150,000 people in their population already. And their population is only 800,000, so it's not very far away. Their first lady recently went on record asking people, pleading with people to come and take these vaccines as they already have so many, and the intention is to have as much of their population vaccinated as soon as possible. It could seem understandable to me why a lot of the Caribbean seems to have more trust in the Russian vaccine, whether it just be that they have no real knowledge of why they don't trust the AstraZeneca vaccine, or the stories they've heard about the AstraZeneca has frightened them. And truth be told, there are just as much scary stories about the Sputnik vaccine. But the Sputnik vaccine also is a bit of older technology, so some people may feel more comfortable with that style and that technology. And it being a state-run organization that came up with this vaccine, there isn't the same monetary incentive that some may worry about with some of the larger pharmaceuticals, and particularly some of those associated with Bill Gates. And the suspicion around him, sometimes a lot of it is conspiratorial and isn't really making any sense, but some of it, especially when pertaining to the side of the fact that he is just a billionaire, and what a lot of what he aims at is intended on enriching himself also. So I don't think you even need to look far for some of these conspiracies and worry about if he's seeking to control the world and make the world infertile and all these other things. It's quite clear that it seems like a lot of this is about profiteering and making as much profit for the pharmaceutical companies as possible. Either way, regardless of how you think about it, whether you think of the profit side of it, whether you think it has to do with the trust factor in these vaccines, whether people would trust them if they come from less known or smaller countries, a lot of the epidemiologists and a lot of the scientists, when speaking about this COVID pandemic, they're saying that it seems the only way through this is by vaccinating as much of the population as possible. And this vaccination would need to increase greatly over the next year. And whichever measures you think would make more sense to increase this vaccination output. And I also think by lifting the patent on some of these vaccines, it may actually increase the trust in these vaccines. If some people can see that it's not just one shady unknown company that's backed by a billionaire or something creating these vaccines are being created all over by different countries and the recipes are known. It isn't something that is strange. We can look behind it and see behind the curtain, as it were, and that may increase the trust in some of these vaccines, and it may allow some people to understand that the dangers in these vaccines may in fact be less dangerous than the COVID-19 pandemic on a whole, and this may be how we get out of it. Or maybe Russia can be our savior and some of the less trusting parts of the world may go towards the Russians and buy their Sputnik vaccines in great amounts like Guyana is doing. But something needs to be done. And I think, especially in Trinidad, where at the moment we seem to be on a low with vaccines, some of these decisions are ahead of us. And it would be interesting to see which direction it goes.